Hey, what's up, world? I'm Kat Harvey, the CEO of the top-rated show, KHSNL. And today, I have an extraordinary guest today. He needs no introduction. He's a boss. He's a mogul. He's a father. He's a husband, entrepreneur. He's changing lives all over the world, bestseller. He needs no introduction. He's nothing but family to me, and I'm sure he's going to be family to you guys. Please welcome Mr. Sam Richards. How are you?
I'm great, Kat. How are you? Thanks for having me
I'm amazing. Thanks for coming so much.
Yes.
So can you introduce yourself to the world today?
Well, my name is Sam Richards, and as you know, I'm the author of the book, From the Bus to the Bentley, No More Limits, which is my autobiography that talks about my struggles growing up in the inner city of Washington, D.C., 7 kids, 3-bedroom apartment, public assistance, graduated from our alma mater, Cadoza High School. However, in 1981, I couldn't read, reading on a sixth grade level when I graduated. Went on from there after a struggle with drugs from 83 to 87. Healed from addiction by God's grace and favor. And then drove a Metro bus for 18 years, working 8 to faint. And then decided to be an entrepreneur around 2006 and got in my industry that I'm in today, the direct sales industry, and been blessed to make millions of dollars. And start my nonprofit, which is my baby, the Richards Group Foundation, and then go up from there and win the Steve Harvey Neighborhood Awards for 2 consecutive years.
That's amazing. You know, speaking again, I mean, you're so profound, and I think you're very key on what's important in life. And then I saw that just a year ago, you celebrated being cancer-free. So
yes.
How does that feel, and did that change your whole outlook on what's most important to you in life today?
Oh, absolutely. In 2015, I was diagnosed with prostate cancer, and it changed my life because at that point in my life, I was 53 years old. I was traveling the world, speaking, signing autographs. I was at the top of my game, went in for a routine physical, and the doctor says, you had prostate cancer. And then I took a deeper look at how I was living, which my eating habits was terrible, you know, which a lot of us have bad eating habits. And growing up in the inner city of Washington, D.C., you ate what you got your hands on. And those bad habits went along in life. And I found out at that point, I was actually addicted to food, right? All the bad eatings. And I had to change my eating habits, which I've done. And today, I'm cancer-free, and I'm excited about that.
Wow, that's amazing. One of the most, I've watched you all the time. You guys don't know, I've known this guy since I was 18 years old. Mm-hmm. He's part of the reason why my show is so successful, and definitely challenged me to think outside the box, to challenge myself, and definitely help me find my passion, because I know for a very long time I wasn't sure what I wanted to do. I thought it was accounting, and it definitely wasn't that, and I stumbled upon that, but I definitely owe you that, and I'm so appreciative, and I will never forget you and Charisse,
yes,
for instilling, you know, just those core values that allow me to be successful today.
Yeah, well, I'm going to tell you, Kat, when I first met you, I seen greatness in you. And I always told you that,
yeah. You
know, and now I'm excited to see what you're doing, because I always believe there's 3 things. There's purpose, people, and profits. Mm. And now you found your purpose. And I tell people all the time, you find your purpose by setting small goals. Goals lead to your purpose, and purpose lead to your passion.
That's true.
Yeah.
So one of the most important lessons, you know, you and Charisse talk about is integrity and vision.
Sure.
How did you know, as a business person, when it was time to transition in business? And then I know you caught some heat with doing that. So how were you able to cope and do it classy?
Well, you know, I always believe that you reap what you sow in life. My mother always taught me character and living in integrity. And I was in the entertainment business for 20 years. And I did well in the 90s, but I started to lose money when the economy went south. And from that point, that was my, you know, I had a passion for that, but at the end of the day, sometimes that, you know, you're chasing something that may not be working at that time. Mm-hmm. And that's when I tell people all the time, always open your mind up to new possibilities. And then I was introduced to this industry, the direct sales industry, and I embraced it because it just made sense and was able to go on and do really, really well. And then from there, I had to make another decision from leaving a service-based company to doing products. And what happened there is when I was diagnosed with the cancer. Mm. And I started looking at how I was eating, but then everybody in my family, my friends, and everybody around me was getting sick and getting diagnosed with cancer at a young age. And then I developed a passion for the whole health and wellness space. So now I'm starting a movement called Healthy, Wealthy, Wise.
I like that. Yes. I like that slogan.
Yes. Yes.
So, you know, I want to talk about your two beautiful boys.
Yes.
So what are the most important lessons you think they've taken away from you from watching you from where you started to where you are right now?
Well, I've always taught them to face your fears, you know, move towards the things that you want in life. And we all know what fear is, false evidence appearing real. Yeah. I always taught you that,
yeah.
Right? And I told them that whatever your dreams are, to go for them, because go for it, because a lot of times we dream too small. And my sons watch me go from a blue collar bus driver to a very successful businessman, and it's all because I've always been able to face my fears,
okay.
Right?
Well, he hit the nail right on the head with that one. So what were some of your biggest stories? You know, I know we all have New Year's resolutions that you felt like you had to get rid of this year in order to see more prosper and more growth for 2017.
Well, what I had to do is I had to, again, embrace my struggle, which was food again, because now I'm in the health and wellness space. And that was my biggest struggle. In order for me to go out and help you win your battle, I had to win my battle.
Yeah.
And that was my dark secret, you know, after my drug addiction in the 80s. Mm. And, you know, now that it was the food addiction, I tell people all the time that food is the new crack cocaine in the 80s, you know, the epidemic, because sugar is 10 times more addictive than crack cocaine. Mm. And people don't realize that because we're moving and shaking. So I had to face that and then be comfortable with going out and fighting that beast, because I didn't know if I could win that battle, you know, but I'm winning the battle now every day because I'm 55 now. I feel like I'm 30.
I'm gonna say, you don't look like it.
Yeah, I feel like I'm 30 years old. I feel freaking amazing. I got more energy than I ever had. And a lot of people are watching and they're saying, you know what? I want to look good and feel good and live a healthy, prosperous life as well.
And then that comes with also keeping the wrong people out of your circle. How do you do that on a continual basis?
Well, I tell people all the time, get rid of your fat friends, right? I mean, really. So what I did was I got in community, you know, around people who I wanted to look like. I have personal trainers that, you know, I do a boot camp every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 5:30. Right, so you have to get in community around people who are going to inspire you. So I don't hang out with the guys drinking like I used to. You know, I'm not knocking that,
yeah.
But you know, I want to my body to be healthy. So I had to get rid of the alcohol. I had to get rid of the fried foods and things like that. So I had to get in community with people who inspire me to look good and feel good.
That's true. So you guys, I know Sharice is not here. That's his lovely, beautiful wife. Sharice is going to come next time, though.
Yes.
We miss her. So you guys are going to come up on 17 years of marriage.
Yes.
How does one get there, and was that easy?
No, absolutely not. Let me just share this with you, Kat. You know, we have a brand called Love and Business, How to Build a Million-Dollar Business with Your Spouse. Well, let me tell you, relationships, number one, need time.
Mm.
Okay. And that's why the divorce rate is so high, because people don't have time. Everybody's busy, busy, busy. And relationships need time. But then number two is we are always open to change. Our relationship today is not what it was when we first started. So as you, nothing stays the same. Everything changes. So you have to be able to change, right? And you have to be able to embrace change. And then number three, you know, you have to be each other's biggest cheerleader.
Mm.
You know, I pushed my wife to greatness. She pushed me to greatness. And you have to be friends. You have to like each other.
Yes.
And we've liked each other from day one. Okay, even though when we would get upset and do what, you know, we have our issues too.
Yeah,
but
right.
Guess what? I tell everybody, just don't fall out of love at the same time. And you'll make it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, you know, so many people, especially young people like myself, I know all my friends, they're scared to get married because it's a lot of people cheating and,
yeah,
and things like that. So what do you have to say to those people, especially me, how we cannot get discouraged from finding the right person to marry and to grow with?
Oh, absolutely. Marriage is a beautiful thing. You know, me and my wife have an amazing marriage. And I tell people that you can have it all in marriage. But what I want you to do is always be open, you know, to meet that person. It's never going to be a perfect person, right, but meet that person, okay, who treats you like the queen that you deserve to be treated. You've always watched me treat my wife like a queen, yeah, and you deserve to be treated that way as well. So always be open to receive that. And I say all the time, is treat people the way you want to be treated. Okay, I've never cheated on my wife because I want my wife cheat on me. You know what I'm saying? And yeah, I do believe, I'm a firm believer. I talk about it in my book. We reap what we sow.
That's true.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
absolutely. But don't give up.
I know, right?
There's some great guys like Stan Richards out here, right?
I have one.
Yeah, and his name, yeah.
So what's the hardest part of being married, you think, out of everything that you guys have been through?
Well, I don't consider it hard. Just understanding that you're two different people, right? You're just two different people. And here's a huge nugget. I love my wife the way she needs to be loved, and she loved me the way I need to be loved. And that's two different ways of being loved. You know what I'm saying? Like, let me break it down to you. Like, she wants time and attention. So she'll tell me a story and got to go always around Robin Hood's bar. Okay, all I want to know is the bottom line.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But that's how she needs to be loved. She needs time. She needs attention. So when we're together, I'm not on my cell phone. I'm not on Facebook. Mm. She has all my undivided attention.
Right.
Right? She loves it. That's the way she needs to be loved. Okay? The way I need to be loved, I need a pat on my head,
yeah,
and saying you're doing a great job. And then I need all of her. Yes, how about, right?
Yes. Makes me laugh. Oh my God.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah, that's how the man need to be.
Yeah,
we don't
exactly
need all of that.
Yeah.
We need something to eat. We need a pat on the head.
Yeah.
And say you're doing a great job.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. So, you know, speaking of fights, what do you think has been the hardest fight that you had to endure?
In what area?
Business or in personal?
Well, again, you know, the hardest fight is myself. Mm. All these internal stories that we tell ourselves that ain't real. Trust me, let me tell you, and I say this all the time, Kat, we were all born great. Think about it. Yeah. There were millions of sperm cells racing towards that egg. And guess who won? Kat won.
Yes.
And Stan won.
Yes.
So we were born great. But then when we got into this world, we started creating all these stories that ain't real. And society started to shape our beliefs, mm-hmm, right? Yeah. So the biggest struggle even today, okay, is again, facing those fears that, the unknown every day that we wake up, okay? And that's why I'm excited, because I know that I was born great. I'm here to give and serve the earth. Okay, and as long as I keep that in front of me, I can't lose. But guess what? I have to tell myself that every day. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. It does. So I know you're a spiritual man. So when do you feel like you saw God's favor the most?
Oh, my God. When I was on drugs. I was on cocaine from 83 to 87. A functional addict, which means that I could go to work and everything like that. But I took all my money and bought drugs with, right? And my mother, who was a prayer warrior, she prayed for me, along with a pastor called K.C. Price, Dr. Fred Price, prayed for me in 1987, right? And we hear these stories and these miracles. But once he prayed for me, I never used cocaine again. And that's just one. I got tons of stories. When I got into the industry that I'm in of direct sales, by me being a blue-collar worker, never spoke in front of people a day in my life, I didn't think that I could do it. And I prayed and asked God to give me what I need to get me to the top of the company. And so you've seen yourself with me speak in front of 10,000 people.
Yeah.
So I did all that with my PhD, public high school diploma. Right? I'm not qualified, but I am qualified,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So I've seen miracle after miracle, and God is just amazing. And then we're going to do some more things through the whole Healthy, Wealthy, Wise movement.
Okay, okay. Yes. So how have you dealt with the people who were not the best supporters in the beginning? And I mean, even now, how do you deal with those people?
Well, it's hard because, you know, I love people. And I want to be loved. That's a weakness, right? But everybody's not a Stan Richards fan. Everybody don't love me just because, right? And it was hard for me to figure out, well, why they don't like me anymore? I mean, what did I do? You know, I just made a decision to go to another company because I thought it was best situation for me and my family.
Right.
But then people that I've taught and trained turned around and cursed me, right? So I had that was a hard pill to swallow, but I had to learn to move on because everybody's just not gonna like you.
Yeah.
Right. Of course. And that's tough.
And it ain't gonna stop your blessing.
It's not gonna stop it.
Right.
Right.
I know that's right. So a critical pivotal day. He may not know that I'm about to ask him this. July 23rd, 2016. You and Charisse were hit by a drunk driver.
Yeah.
I was very shocked. I actually prayed. I stopped what I was doing. My mom sent me a text. I think I was getting off the plane. I want you to talk about that and how it happened and what was going through your mind and what did you learn out of that? Because I feel like everything God gives us is a lesson behind it. So can you talk about that for a second?
Well, number one, never take life for granted. Live life to the fullest every day that you wake up. Let me just tell you real quickly, Kat, we had just got in from L.A. We had taken our kids on a vacation to L.A. for a week, you know, shopping spree. I mean, it was in July. It was right around my oldest son's birthday. So we went to L.A., had a great time. And then right before we got on the plane to come back, you know, my son, who's a teenager, little Stan, the teenagers are teenagers.
Yeah.
So he and I had some words, and I was pretty upset with him because, you know, in my opinion, he was disrespectful to me and he was unappreciative to what we had just given him. And I just didn't like his attitude. So we got on a plane and we came back. It was so heated. What we decided to do when we land was to take him to his grandmother's house because we needed some space, mm-hmm. me and him, because there's only one king in my house.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So we dropped him off. And then it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. We get on the Beltway. We come around the Beltway. The Beltway is empty pretty much. And we're driving home. We're at 55 miles an hour in the middle lane. And then all of a sudden, I hear some boom, hit the rear end of the car. We spun around, hit the guardrail. The car flipped over. Mm. Okay? When I looked up, the car was upside down. Charisse had to kick the front windshield out. And all I could begin to do is pray because there was a tractor trailer that was actually right behind us. We couldn't even see behind us. So Charisse had to crawl out, take my 10-year-old Isaiah out the back. Then she had to come back and get me. Of course, right, got me last night. So a mother's love, right?
Yeah.
So when she came back to get me, my seatbelt was stuck.
Mm.
And all I could think of was somebody was going to hit us on that beltway. And we were able to get out of that accident, right? But it was a lesson learned that I believe that was for my son, okay? That, you know what, don't take life for granted because your parents could have been gone.
Yeah.
You know, so, hey, I just thank God for his miracles,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you shared that with us. I know you weren't expecting me to ask you that.
I wasn't.
I thought it was very pivotal because, you know, we ripping and running, and we don't think it could happen to
us.
You know? And that's why I'm so key upon calling my mom every day or when I am home and I stop by the house, I make sure I kiss her every single day.
Absolutely.
Because you don't know when that last.
Yeah, that's why you always hear me hashtagging no more limits.
Yeah.
No more limits. Live the life to the fullest. Love the people. Forgive people because you don't know when it's your last day.
That's true. That's true. So I want to talk about the Richards Group Foundation.
Awesome.
And how important it is, you know, for us as African Americans to look after one another. So tell us what you guys have been up to.
Well, you know, my motto with the foundation is we learn, we earn, and we return.
Yeah.
It's our duty. I share this with you.
Yeah.
It's your duty to go back to Cardoza High School, and inspire someone, not motivate, inspire, right? With all your success. It's our duty as we get up the ladder to go back. So with the foundation, what we're doing is we're going back into the community. Sharice has a group of girls. I have a group of young men that we inspire to be doing half and be the, all that they can be. Okay, and one of the communities that I've been working in is over at Brooklyn Manor, where I grew up. The same projects where I grew up, I go back over there. I got a couple of kids that's graduating this coming June.
Oh, wow,
I'm so excited.
Great.
When I first met these kids, they could barely read, they could barely talk, okay? And then they're graduating with honors. So I'm excited about
that. That's great, yeah. So I want to talk about these two beautiful books before we wrap up. From the Bus to the Bentley, and you have a mission. So tell the people why they need to get both books.
Well, this book here is my autobiography. Okay. And this book is for everyone. Whether you grew up in the hood, whether you come out of corporate America, whether you're a small business owner, you need to read this book. I have six principles in here that will help you to have success in life. Okay? One is faith. One is discipline, humility, positioning yourself around the right people, big vision, and then character.
Yeah.
These are my six principles for success. But this book is amazing. I've sold them all over the country and around the world as I've traveled. And then this book here is with my two mentors, Dr. George C. Frazier. Okay, we co-authored this book called A Mission Unstoppable, right? And Les Brown. There's also 30 other authors, okay, who have rags to riches stories. And what I'm proud about with this book is I tell everybody to get a mentor.
Yeah,
Dr. Frazier, this guy is amazing. I've never, ever met anybody like him. And he's just poured back into my life over the last 6 years. And I'm excited about that. So it's very, very important that you have a mentor as you're going along in life. Because guess what? If you knew it, you would already do it, right?
Yeah.
So you need someone to tell you your gaps in your life,
yeah,
right?
That's true.
And someone that's going to tell you all of the things that's stopping you from getting to that next level.
So what has money taught you at the end of the day?
Money has taught me that we need to have it. We can't live without it, okay?
Yeah, we
but
do.
But let me tell you something about money. When I first started making money, because I grew up so poor and broke, I used to hoard it because I always thought I was going to be broke. So I was scared to spend it because I didn't want to be broke again. But money is very, very key because you need money in order to go back and make a real impact and a difference on the world. Like, you know, we self-fund our nonprofit, so we need money. You know what I'm saying? But money is a beautiful thing. And what it's there for is to give, to serve others. You know what I'm saying? And that's why we need it. Yes?
Can you give advice to the young males that's out there that maybe not think it's important for them to give back, and also for the males that's watching, that they can also be service and help somebody else out?
Yeah, well, if you're a young male, what I'm going to share with you is that the clock is ticking, and you need to start figuring out what is it that you want. And once you become successful, I just spoke at a high school last week, Surrattsville High School, and one of the things that I told the kids is that your community, your high school is your duty, right? And it's very, very important that you start thinking entrepreneurship. We need to be owners. One of the challenges with this next generation is that they've been taught to go to school, get a good education, and get a good job. There's nothing wrong with that. That pays the bill. But we need to start teaching our kids to go to college to create jobs and not just work them.
Yeah.
Consider yourself. You're not working in your field. You went and got, it paid the bills for a minute, but that's not what you wanted. So what we need to do is start talking. Like my sons, they're taught to be owners. A job will be secondary to them. So the young males that's coming through now, I challenge them to dig deep and find out what their passion and go for their passion and their purpose, okay? Because that's what's going to create the profits for them.
That's true. So what's the ultimate vision for yourself?
The ultimate vision for myself is just be the best example that I can be to the world. And right now I'm working, I'm excited about that, and it's all because of my whole movement around healthy, wealthy, wise, Okay, let me talk about that real briefly. Number one, we need to take care of our temple, okay? Because everybody's moving and shaking, and there's a Chick-fil-A down the street and a Burger King down the street, and it's doing you no good.
Yeah.
But you're not stopping because, you know, only when the alarm goes off. But guess what? If you notice, people are getting sick, obesity, right? So we need to become more conscious about our health. Number two, our wealth. We need multiple streams of income. We need 5 to 7 streams of income, not just one, okay? And then number three, we need to exercise wisdom. What do I mean by that, okay? When I made my, when I got on my bus job, my Metro bus job, and Sharice was in the federal government, we both made 6 figures. We went and bought the biggest house that we could find. Yeah. I had the nice Lexus, smoked out off the 20s, right? With the check engine light on, right? To impress people that I didn't like and didn't know. Mm. So when we talk about wisdom, rich and wealthy people walk around. You never see Mark Zuckerberg. You see him with a white T-shirt on. Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, white T-shirt. Yeah. But when they go see the wizards, they're sitting on the floor. So we have it all twisted. We go buy the nice Mercedes and a nice BMW and a nice Bentley, and we live in an apartment.
Yep.
Okay? So when we talk about wisdom, we're talking about once we create the wealth, we must become good stewards and position ourselves to leave generational wealth, number one, and then number two, give back to our community. So that's the ultimate goal.
Okay.
Yes?
Well, I thank you so much for your time today. It means the world to me. I had to have this boss, my mentor, and Sharice is here with us in spirit. So can you tell the world where they can find and connect with you at?
Sure, absolutely. StanRichardsOnline.com is my website. And then they can also call me direct at 301-520-4348.
Okay.
Well, I'm a real guy from around the way.
He does pick up the phone. Well, thank you, guys. You guys check out the boss himself, Mr. Stan Richards. I'm Kat Harvey. Till next time. Success, nothing less.